I think the catalyst for me to take myself a bit more seriously and make some work about myself was when I went to Mexico. I travelled there in 2006, I think it was. When I was in Mexico City, I went and had a look at Frida Kahlo's studio. A third of her work's self-portraits, and I've always been interested in self-portraiture and how to depict the self. So I went to her studio, and when you walk in, like, it's a beautiful place, the gardens and the colour and stuff. But when you walk into the actual studio, they've got her bed set up, they've got her cast, her walking sticks and her fake leg and all this kind of weird medical paraphernalia. Apart from that, they've got all her journals around the room. Her paints are still set up. To see that in the space that she actually works was pretty amazing and pretty inspiring. And with the medical paraphernalia, you know, they've got this box in the middle with this glass case pretty much. And inside are all the different tablets and balms and you name it. Not so much at the time, but looking back after that, sort of took it in. When I got back to Australia, I sort of thought about that experience, and really that, I think that was the catalyst for me to start making work about me. A lot of people don't know, but I've had two lots of open heart surgery. So I was born with tricuspid atresia. I had my first lot of open heart surgery when I was 18 months old. And then when I was 15, I had another go at it. And even when I went to uni and decided to study art, a lot of my lecturers said, you should make work about yourself, about your health situation. And I was always kind of like, no, I don't want to do that, because it was sort of just a part of my life. But then, after I went to Mexico and got back, I really thought I should actually start making some work about myself. So that was when I sort of went back through my journals and realised that the experience being in Kahlo's studio was really a kick in the pants for me to actually take myself a bit more seriously and make some work about my life, some autobiographical work. Sitting down, going through my journals, I embarked on making this autobiographical work, looking at the idea of mortality and thin line between life and death. A bit of a revelation for me to actually, you know, stop all the bullshit and actually just focus on the autobiographical, making work for me and about me. Because I think, you know, with the success of the work, it's, you know, I've read a quote, I'm not sure where it's from now, but it says that the most personal work is often the most universal. After that show, I got picked up by Schubert's gallery in August, I think, that following year, 2009. And which Schubert's finally closed, I think, April of next year. And Anthea Polson Art was born, so they took me on. And so then kind of life steps in, and I was at a party, and I was out in the balcony, and the balcony railing collapsed, and I fell 6 metres. With this experience, I was really scared, because I've lived with my heart problem for my whole life. It's just, it's been me, you know. I've never known anything different. So it's a time where, you know, of great introspection. Just using all your power and to sort of go back into yourself and try to survive this. And it's kind of like life just sort of grabbed me and pulled me off this conveyor belt where I sort of knew I was heading. You know, I was still drawing, watching TV series, reading a lot. But it was a very intense time of sort of drawing yourself back into your body. When I actually returned to Brisbane, made a show where I looked at, I guess, a lot of my influences, a lot of painters that inspired me, but a lot of people that, artists that have had darkness in their life, whether it's mental illness or physical ailments or physical illness, or, you know, writers as well, people that have sort of embraced this darkness and tried to, or have created beauty out of it, whether if it was work or paintings or writing, and whether they actually triumphed and came out the other side, or actually it still defeated them, but the work, the beautiful stuff, was left behind. So I was looking at those sort of themes, and so I was trying to, like, embrace that kind of darkness in my life and the dark periods, and then trying to create something beautiful out of it too. So the next body of work was the natural progression from that was to actually go back and actually explore the sort of triumph of that actual experience. So, you know, with the darkness and the beauty thing, it was kind of like more of a exploring that mental space or ideas of that, of going from dark to light. I wanted to be more about the again about the sort of the mental triumph and using symbols from that experience to make that evident, I guess. So the show then I painted was called Formula for Resurrection. One of the paintings I did for that show was entitled 100 Days, because it was pretty much 3 months that I was there. In that painting, it's this symbolic painting of my mum actually knitting me back together. So it's a self-portrait. I used the knitting as a symbol of triumph, I guess, of getting better and actually sort of day-to-day, row by row, making yourself better again. That exhibition, it was kind of a mixture of mixed media stuff, with just like oil, a lot of oil stick, a lot of thick acrylic and stuff, and then the stretch paperwork. It afforded me the ability to go in and actually start playing in the studio again, seeing what I wanted to make. So I started playing with watercolour, and watercolour for me was always, you know, for old people on Sundays and for painting boats and flowers. And I looked at using watercolour to actually, can I make it work out of watercolour? Because I've used it a little bit with, you know, life drawing and stuff like that, and sketches and ideas. And I just kind of fell in love with it, because it's so frustrating to start with, because the way I do it anyway is sort of layer upon layer of colour, you know, waiting for one layer to dry. And then so you're adding all these sort of beautiful transparent colours together. I had a show in Mildura. I had a residency down there, and the show was called Blood is Thicker Than Water. Doing a watercolour painting is like, you know, you're holding hands with, you know, your medium and your skill set, and you're all standing there and you're like, okay, we can sort of do this together. It's kind of about subverting the watercolour into these kind of violent, horrific portraits, self-portraits and portraits of my brother. It's much about brotherly love as it is about, you know, the ridiculous side of being a male. And so it was kind of that duality playing together, and then using this beautiful medium. I mean, I was just obsessed with painting the black eye, and it became sort of a meditation actually working on the watercolour. So you're laying down all these beautiful colours. So then I became kind of really obsessed with watercolour, and I feel like this crazy old craftsman. You know, you've got to have the paper stretched, and you've got to soak the paper and stretch the paper, and everything's got to be set up and perfect and clean, and you've got to have your watercolours set. And so you got all these things that you do. There's no room to make a mistake. You know, I've always been a drawer ever since I was, you know, Mum says ever since I was three, ever since I could hold a pencil, I was drawing. So the foundation is all about drawing. You know, it's at the base of my practice. You know, painting's always been the secondary concern for me. It's really all about the facility of line and composition for me. I'm not really concerned if you want to call me a drawer or a painter. You know, what I'm interested in is making interesting images. And I think for me, the way I can do that is with drawing and with focusing on compositions and elements within the pictorial space to, I guess, guide your eye and to draw you into what I'm trying to argue or discuss. The drawing comes first, and then the beautiful part about it, and the interesting part about it, was actually using this new medium and putting the colour down. And with this new show that I've got at the moment, Kings, Popes and Other Fools, it just needed to be media for me. To sort of give you a bit of a background of that show, with the subject that I was exploring, always been interested in religious art, the motif and the narratives within that, and just the colours and the gold leaf and all the icon paintings and, you know, this epic story, you know, the most epic story of all. If I was to make a religious work, what would it look like? And I guess there's always been those kind of epic elements of life and death and stuff within my works, but to actually try to discuss that directly, what is that going to look like, you know? Listening to Hitchens and the Four Horsemen of the Apocalypse and the rationalist theories and stuff, you know, started to question, what are my beliefs being raised a Catholic, and sort of coming up a bit short, especially after having these two lots of open heart surgery and this life-threatening fall where, you know, I could have easily died. When I was thinking about making the show, I went and did some research, got a heap of reference images and made up these collages. And after looking at the collages, I just couldn't imagine them as watercolours. I need to actually argue with the canvas and with the images to make that a valid discussion for myself. I needed to be arguing with myself all the time. I didn't want to have these perfectly laid out, you know, images where I knew that was going to go there, and that didn't seem legitimate to me. So, you know, I went and got the oils out and started, and still drawing as a base to all the work, compositions, you know, doing some drawing straight on the canvas with graphite and charcoal, you know, some fine rendered work. Then having the ability to, you know, wipe that away and actually lay some thick paint on and get the painting knives out and really sort of argue with the canvas. I didn't win the argument all the time, and there was about three or four canvases that actually won that day or that week or whatever that I was working on that. So keeping the works on a sort of a knife edge to whether they're going to be a success or not, and sort of pushing ideas of portraiture and image making that I sort of hadn't resolved with previous work. That was the exciting part for me, and frustrating. Like, it was equally as frustrating, this show, making this work, as it was exciting and fulfilling in the end. The ability to use drawing with thick oil and, you know, washed out oil and bits of acrylic and gold leaf, really heavy and beautiful, stronger colours than I usually use, sort of weightiness about it, in my mind became my version of a religious painting. Setting it up, drawing it and working with composition, I'm always sort of playing with the idea of not only how it reads to me, but how it reads pictorially. And you can see that in a lot of my work, points of realism, so that the viewer connects with that and then is sort of drawn into the work, almost if I'm giving them a hand in, and then to come in and then sort of try to unpack the work and get something of what I'm actually discussing. That play on recognition and understanding and then feeling and actually experiencing the work as well. The larger audience appreciates realism and super realism because they can understand it and they can unpack it really quickly. So if you use that as a device, then that can sort of draw them in, and then you can sort of walk them around with the arm around the shoulder and help them figure out the rest of it. Kings, Popes and Other Fools. It started off being, number one, me trying to make these religious paintings. But after, you know, listening to the rationalist theories and reading God Is Not Great, I really wanted to make some comments. It wasn't me trying to attack the church, or not particularly the state of the church, but the state of my, I guess, unpacking of it and sort of think and discuss my own thoughts about it and beliefs. You know, and I didn't want it to make it completely serious and overbearing and heavy, because I guess that's just not the kind of person that I am. I wanted to make it visually interesting and to fulfil that idea of a religious painting for me. I guess just pose some questions and use some symbols that people recognise. I've used chimps in my paintings before, and I've used them as kind of a symbol of that primitive emotional state. So I've used it as sort of my other self, my primal state, my primal, you know, idea of fear. The chimps sort of represent our primitive state, our good state. Also that idea of evolution. That tiny bit of difference is the cause of all the beauty in the world, all the music and the art and the great ideas and the love. But it's also the cause of all the shit, all the destruction and hate and desecration and jealousy and all that sort of stuff. And that's sort of amazing to me. You know, I wasn't really looking to come up with any answers. With this particular work, it's a large nude that I've painted just at the end of the Kings, Popes and Other Fools show. So when the work actually left the studio, I had a bit of a breathing space, you know, it was kind of like out of sight, out of mind thing. So I really wanted to explore. So I wanted to make work about kind of like modern bodies. And again, sort of trying to, I'm always really interested in mixing drawing with painting. And what is a drawing, what is a painting? I mean, as I said before, all my work is about drawing, but for me, I really need to be invested in the whole process. That the process of actually making the work is just as important to me as what it's going to look like at the end. If I'm not excited about making the work, then it just won't happen, you know, it won't get made. I'm not one of the artists that has sort of gets a great idea and lays it all down and then goes, all right, step one through to four, and then it's finished. I want to be in the discussion the whole time with the work, you know, and I don't know what it's going to look like. And when I drew this, I didn't know that was the face I was going to put in, or that was the hand, or how much paint to actually use on the image, or how much to wipe away and how thick to paint. And that's all sort of the secondary concern for me. And that's what I find exciting about that sort of drawing-painting combo. When you're working with oils and stuff, it's like more of an argument because it's such a large canvas, it was this really sort of active, engaging thing to do. You know, I felt really, it was giving me as much energy as I was giving it, sort of thing. So, had all these three or four drawings, so I did just the drawings on top of each other, and sort of just created this kind of, crazy web-like series of lines on this canvas. And then after the fact, I came in with some reference photos that I had taken, and then sort of brought some, some realism back into it. This was actually getting all the life drawings down, and then choosing what to paint, which arm to paint in, or which hand, or is that the line of the leg, or whatever, and sort of pulling out these different elements to sort of bring it into focus, I guess. Cool. So it was kind of the reverse process from the watercolour paintings, where I'd do the painting first and then do the line on top. So with those works, I was putting the watercolour down first, but then after doing that, I felt like it needed some sort of invigoration. So at the end, when I'd finished the watercolour, the nude, what I'd do was get out the old drawings, the initial marks that I made, and then go over the top. So, spending 1 or 2 weeks laying down all this colour and building up this image, and then right at the very end, making the marks over the top. So the kind of this finally rendered image is then reinvigorated by the initial lines that gave it birth to start with on top. So it sort of gives a bit more of that initial energy back into the work, which is what I was sort of playing with then. Like, what is it to do a nude, and what is it to do a life drawing? And I'm really interested in working with the figure and being a figurative painter. I like to explore that idea of, manipulating the idea of, realism and distorting figure, and, drawing's always been the basis to my work, but I'd like to explore that painting side of things further. I'd like to, push my own envelope, if it's someone else's envelope, then that's fine too, but embark on creating the most interesting work I can, which is that work between drawing and painting, and that idea between, abstraction and realism. Like, people, say, why do you paint yourself a lot? And I don't think of them as self-portraits. It becomes a symbol of myself in that particular mindset. So when I'm thinking about what I feel like in hospital, I kind of paint a self-portrait about that emotion, and that's, and some of the self-portraits I've done, I obscure the eyes. And if the eyes are obscured, then is it a portrait? Like, because we've so much focused on the eyes, and if the eyes are there, it's a, that's a, set standard portrait, we can understand that. But if the eyes are blurred, well, you're still a face, you still know it's a person, but it becomes this interesting object then. So I like playing with that idea of how much do you have to give for it to be real, or for people to connect to it. I like to explore that a bit more in painting and in figuration, like how much information can you put on the canvas and how much can you take away, and for it still to be engaging enough to draw your interest in, but then sort of obscure enough for you to get lost in it and have to make your own decisions about what the work is. I really want to continue at the moment with making some large nudes. So I'm really interested in all those sort of those aspects of being a figurative painter. You're here in the studio in your own head, and you're working away, and whether it takes you 2 hours or 2 weeks or 2 months to do a painting, you've got to give all that energy, and then it's got to be interesting enough and engaging enough. So when someone walks past it, what have they got? 10 seconds? 20 seconds? 2 minutes if you're lucky? That they're going to stand there and try to get get what you're trying to talk about and understand. The most personal work is often the most universal. So I think if I focus on that and sort of trying to make authentic paintings for myself, then hopefully then that sort of transcribes to the audience.
Mm-hmm.